Hello everyone, and welcome back. Today we're going to be doing the first mission guide. This is more new player oriented, so the gray beards among you might not learn as much from this video, but there'll probably be something in here that'll pique your interest, so stick around. I'll be covering every mission in the game, and today we'll be starting with Morkite mining. Taking a look at mining over in the Miner's Manual, crazy how that works out, we can see that it's one of the more simple missions in the game. Mine Morkite, put it in the mule, hit the button, and get to the drop pod. Very simple stuff. A lot of these elements you'll see in other missions in the game, such as depositing your resources, calling the drop pod, and getting there, obviously. So really the only unique factor to mining is mining Morkite. Morkite is a dull blue mineral that glows in the dark. Pretty easy to find. You can see a big vein of it right here. We'll get into that more once we're in the mission. This is also the first mission type you'll ever play, so I assume most of you are already acquainted with how to beat it. Morkite missions do come in quite a few different variations though, ranging from 200, 225, and let's see if we can find another. There's a 200, and another 200. So you can have 200, 225, 300, or 400 Morkite missions. These will be directly affected by the mission length and cave complexity. This will give you an extra percentile bonus on top of the extra XP you'll get from the longer objectives themselves. So 400 Morkite mining can be some of the most XP you can get from a single mission in the game. However, they can be very time consuming if you take your time. So with that in place, let's go ahead and take a look at the build really quickly. Here's my perks. Cycle overload shotgun. Compact rounds. Proxy mines. And just a normal sentry platform gun and armor setup for me. If you'd like to see more about my builds, you can check out my Carl GG. Or just look at some of my older videos on the engineer. Alright, without further ado, let's get started. So I will be leaving the gameplay largely untouched and just interjecting my commentary where it feels appropriate. So first thing out of the drop pod, we want to clear out the spawn room, which in this case thankfully contains a lot of the gunk seeds we need for the secondary objective. But the spawn room usually contains at least a little bit of Morkite and some Nitra. So it's always good to take a glance around so you don't miss anything that was easy to obtain. Right here we have it, our main objective, Morkite. By collecting enough of this and depositing it into the mule, it will allow us to exit the mission whenever we're ready. Always good to get an early start on Nitra in these missions, as the swarms are time-based. More about that later, but basically getting the first 80 Nitra is very important before you run out of ammo. And with all 9 of our gunk seeds collected from the first room, which is incredibly fortunate, we can go ahead and move on. Right here we see a dirt wall. While you might have seen these briefly in the tutorial, they have different functions and different mission types. In mining missions specifically, they are basically the gateway to the rest of the mission. The general flow of a mining mission is the spawn room is connected to the rest of the cave system by a dirt wall. Upon digging through the dirt wall, you will arrive in a tunnel, and following this tunnel will take you to the next large room that will contain the majority of the resources. In that next large room, there will be another dirt wall, so on and so forth. Rinse and repeat until you either have enough resources and are ready to leave, or you reach a cave that has no dirt wall, meaning that you are out of cave system, and that if you don't have enough Morkite at that point, you need to backtrack and find it. Here we arrive at our first full cave. These caves are usually full of a large amount of resources, gold, morkite, nitra, or any other events in the mission, like machine events, crates, helmets, that kind of thing. Immediately upon entering one of these rooms, you might be able to see the dirt wall from where you start. Take mental note of this and try to remember where it is, as once you get the room mostly cleared out, you're going to be wanting to make a beeline directly for the dirt to get to the next room. Something you can do to aid in this is setting a waypoint. By pulling out the laser pointer and pressing the interact button, you can place a permanent waypoint that's only visible to you, that shows up on the terrain scanner and on your screen whenever you pull out the laser. This can be helpful if you often forget about where the dirt is and want to be able to keep track of it. By the time that you clear out the first cave, you can usually expect the first swarm to attack, especially on the higher hazards. If you move quickly, you can usually get through the first cave on lower difficulties, but as a good rule of thumb, you should expect some heavy combat by the time you're in the first cave, meaning that you should be taking good mental notes of where the nitra is if you can't get it right away, as you're going to be needing it once the swarm is over. So right here the full swarm is announced to me, even though I'm already under siege by a passive wave, so I'm going to go ahead and pull over here to the dirt wall and kind of set up a defensive position. Especially since it's a Mactera plague mutation, I'm going to be wanting to set up a fortified position with a little bit of head cover. So swarms on mining missions. As I alluded to earlier, swarms work differently in different types of missions. For mining missions, they're very simple. At a set interval of time, depending on your difficulty, a swarm will attack you, and then once the swarm is over, it will be announced and you can go back about your business. These swarms will continue to occur at set intervals throughout the mission at a steady pace until you either exit the mission or run out of nitra and ammunition and fail. Other mission types behave very differently in their swarm mechanics, so it's important to understand what kind of swarm mechanics you're dealing with on the mission that you're playing. Mining missions are very simple though. Just go as fast as you can, stop to fight the swarm, and get back to work before the next one arrives. Due to the linear nature of mining missions, it is easy to nitro starve if you are taking your time. So if you do have to pass up a vein of gold or two in order to keep yourselves alive, that might be a good choice. As you can see, while the swarm is winding down, I'm going to start trying to lean back into my work, getting this nitro gold and morkite that's scattered around this corner of the room. As you can see, as I'm waiting for the mule, I'm doing one last courtesy check of the room, making sure I got everything, and once I get all this stuff deposited, we're going to go ahead and roll out to the next cave. I We already had Bosco dig through the dirt for us, so we can just run on through. It's important to get deposits done before you run down long stretches of tunnel, as if you find anything along the way and you're already full of minerals, it can be a huge waste of time to wait on the mule to catch up with you so you can deposit. This can be alleviated largely by having more than one player in the game, of course, and that you have multiple inventories to fill with minerals, but it's usually good practice to get deposits done while you're still in the room with the mule before you take a long run. This is usually the point in the mission that I try to resupply, regardless of the mission length. Once you've made it to your second cave and cleared your first swarm, you should usually be dropping a resupply, as if you don't already need ammo, you're going to be spending a bit of time in the second room, meaning that your resupply will be close by and available whenever you need it. But this isn't a universal rule, as every mission is different and cave generation can be very wonky sometimes, so while this is a good tenet to stick to, read the situation and make sure you're making the right choice. Now, with our quota met, we can leave this mission at any time. However, we still have the secondary objective to finish, and if you care about XP and credit payout, you should definitely be trying to finish secondaries if at all possible. By all means, if you're going to fail a mission, either by nitro starvation or just an overwhelming amount of enemies, it might be the right call to push the button and get out with what you've got, but as secondary objectives are usually worth around 50% of the value of the primary, it's hard to pass them up if you're caring about leveling or resource payouts. A good reason to always go to the end of a mining mission is you might find some rare items like this gold chunk, an error cube, lost helmets, crates, or machine events. So even if you have finished your quota and secondary and you'd like to get out, it might not be a bad idea to at least pop your head into the last room of the cave system and see if there's anything rare there. But once again, this isn't a hard and fast rule. If you feel like just getting out, then by all means, that's the correct decision to make. So with my primary completed and my secondary basically done at this point, just needing to be deposited, I'm going to be looking into wrapping up this mission as quickly and efficiently. However, knowing that I'm currently fighting the second swarm, I know I have a lot of time until the third, meaning I can rinse this room for pretty much everything in it with very little fear of reprisal, as by the time I finish this swarm, I'll have more than enough time to clear everything out before any more heavy bug pressure arrives. Which brings me to one of my last points. While mining extra stuff does carry value, it's not usually worth it if there is any substantial risk or significant time investment. What I mean by this is extra minerals don't hold a lot of value, especially Morkite and Nitra. They provide you 1 XP per unit pre-hazard scaling, which, while it isn't nothing, it is hardly worth staying around in the same mission instead of starting a new one. So keep that in mind whenever you're cleaning out extra cave rooms instead of moving on to the next mission. Once again, this is all personal preference, and if stripping the walls bare gives you more satisfaction than getting more XP per hour, then by all means, make the decision that's right for you. But if you're purely interested in leveling as quickly as possible, I would incentivize you to get the easy minerals that are within your reach and move on to the next mission. For example's sake, I will clean up pretty much the rest of this cave, and then we'll go ahead and hit the button and get on out. Once the button is pressed, the drop pod will descend at a predetermined location, usually around 150 to 200 meters away from your current location as the host of the game. But the location of the mule is also taken into consideration. So if you go far away from the mule and someone else presses the button, it's possible to force the drop pod to land closer to the mule than otherwise would be normal. This is a little tricky to do and takes some communication, so I wouldn't incentivize you to try it on every mission, but overall, just expect to take a long hike once the button is pressed. This is where reverse terraforming really comes in handy, because if you made the caves more traversable for yourself on the first pass, it will make it much easier to return while you're being chased by bugs. Meaning knowing where choke points are, dangerous ledges, high cliffs that are now traversable thanks to platforms or tunnels, just be aware of these things and kind of put mental notes in so that you don't get caught off guard by the Molly crawling straight up a cliff. Now, an important thing to know is that you will not be able to get into the drop pod until the mule arrives. So if you find a decent place to defend yourself that isn't near the drop pod, but is nearby, it might be wise to hold out there instead of just going out in the open near the drop pod. It largely depends on your build whether or not you want to be in open spaces. Scout, for example, will thrive in an open environment where he can dodge bugs. Meanwhile, something with a lot of AoE like Driller, Gunner, Engineer set up correctly can definitely thrive when the bugs are funneling in through a choke point. But that about does it for the mining mission guide. If you feel like I forgot any important information, please leave it in the comments down below. That's usually where all the best information is in my videos. But I digress. If you'd like to catch me live, you can find me over on Twitch. If you'd like to talk about the game or run some missions with me or my community members, you can join us over on Discord. And if you'd like to see more of my builds, you can find those over on CarlGG. As always, thank you for watching, and have a nice day.